very good morning, church. For those who are here, let us just quieten our hearts and our minds, and as we come before the Lord to worship Him. A very good morning, church. Welcome to the house of the Lord. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we have come and rejoice in it. Amen. Let's rise as we come to the call to worship. I will sing of your steadfast love, O Lord, forever. With my mouth, I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations. Together, I declare that your steadfast love is established forever. Your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. You said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to my servant David, and I will establish your descendants forever and build your throne for all generations. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. God and King, His love endures forever. For He is good, He is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. We sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. The setting sun, His love endures forever, and by the grace of God, we will carry on as love and yours forever. Sing praise, sing praise, we sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is wrong, forever God is with us, forever, forever, forever God is faithful, forever God is wrong, forever God is with us, forever. We sing forever, forever God is faithful, forever God is wrong, forever God is with us, forever. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever. Forever. Let's give God a clap of praise, shall we, church? For He is faithful, for He is strong, forever He is with us. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Yes, Lord. Forever You are faithful. Forever You are with us. All through You carry us by Your grace. Church, how have you come to worship the Lord today? Have we come with an expectation? Have we come with a praise offering? Have we come with a burden? Or have we come with our good, usual self? Whatever it is, we have come to worship Him, our God, who loves us more than we can ever imagine. He has done for us what no one else would ever do for us. This morning, rest assured that by that same love and power, He is able to fulfill every word that He says. And you know, church, what's more amazing? It is done.
Shine, Your death has brought the it out. It is done.
It is done. It is done by your blood. It is done. You have overcome the world. It is done. It is done by your blood. It is done.
Let's just take this moment, come to the Lord. Know that the Lord is here among us. Tell the Lord how much you need Him. You need His help in our lives.
Every sickness, every weakness, every fear and doubt and shame, and every burden, and every hurt is overcome in Jesus' name. And every sickness, and every weakness, and every fear and doubt and shame, and every burden, and every hurt is overcome in Jesus' name. And every sickness, and every weakness, and every fear and doubt and shame, and every burden, and every hurt is overcome in Jesus' name. By your blood, it is done. You have overcome the world. It is done. It is done by your blood. It is done. Have overcome the world. It is done. It is done by your blood. It is done. You have overcome the world.
It is done. Let's sing it out.
It is done. It is done by your blood. It is done. You have overcome the
have overcome the world, Lord. Father, even as we are here in your presence this morning, we just want to say that, Lord, we are waiting here for you, Lord.
So let the words of the next song continue to speak to you.
Faith can move the mountains. Let the mountains move. We come with expectation. We're waiting here for you. Waiting here for you.
creation. Still you know my heart, and the altar of salvation. You loved us from the start. Waiting here for you with our hands lifted high in praise. And it's you we adore, singing Alleluia. You are everything you promised. Your faithfulness is true. We're desperate for your presence. All we need is you.
We need you, Lord. We're singing out. We're
waiting here for you with our hands lifted high in praise. And it's you we adore. Turn high in praise, and it's you we adore, singing Alleluia. Singing high in praise, and it's you we adore, singing Alleluia. Waiting here for you.
Throw our heads to the Lord this morning.
With our hands lifted high in praise.
Yes, Lord, you deserve all our honor.
And it's you we adore, singing Alleluia.
We sing it out to the Lord this morning.
Waiting here for you with our hands lifted high in praise.
And it's you, Lord.
And it's you we adore, singing out. Singing Alleluia.
Lord, as we wait for you, help us know your heart and your thoughts, even though we may not fully know them. What we need to know while waiting is that you are faithful. You are everything who you say you are. And that you have loved us from the very beginning of time. Yes, Lord, you who can move mountains and die on the cross for our sake. Such is you, Lord. Such is you whom we worship. Therefore, who do we run to but to you, our Savior? Who knows us completely but you, our Creator? Whose name should we lift up but yours, O God Most High? So to you we bow. Here I bow.
Where would I run but to the throne of mercy? Where would I kneel but at the cross of grace? How great the love, how strong the hand that holds us. Beautiful, so beautiful. So here I bow to lift you high. Jesus, be glorified. The King who bore the scars of healing. There is a Son who came in grace and truth. How great the love that carries us to kindness. Wonderful, you're wonderful. So here I bow to lift you high. Jesus, be glorified in all things. For all my life, I am yours forever. You're so here I bow, so here I bow to yes, Jesus, Jesus, be glorified in all things. For all my life, I am yours forever. Yours, God, here and now, be lifted high. To life, I am yours forever, yours. So here I bow to lift you high. Jesus, be glorified in all things. For all my life, I am yours forever. Yours. So here I bow to lift you high. Jesus, be glorified in all things. For all my life, I am yours forever. Yours, I am yours forever. Yours, I am yours forever. Yours.
Indeed, Lord, we are yours. We are forever yours, O God. Indeed, Lord, in this place, may you be glorified. Whether it's in the small things that we perceive, whether it's in the big things that we perceive, Lord, in this place, in our hearts, in us, may you be glorified. Lord, my God, we are here. We come from different places this morning. Some of us have even challenges, perhaps coming to church with a joyful heart. Some of us is so excited to come to worship together as a congregation. But no matter where we are coming from, Lord, we know that, Lord, you give grace to all of us and you love us. And that's why, Lord, this is your sanctuary. This is your place. And Lord, we thank you for how you have welcomed us in our midst. That you come and even as we worship you, you even continue to minister to us. So God, indeed, may your name be glorified. Congregation, you can either choose to take your seats or you can remain standing, whatever posture you want to take. Yeah. It's your act of worship to the Lord as we continue to just intercede for the Lord our God. From the strength that the Lord our God gives us. We want to intercede for each and every one, for others. And Lord, today we take this opportunity to want to intercede for our friends, our loved ones who have been suffering from physical, emotional illness. God, you are a Lord of mercy. You are a God of love. And as your people, Lord, may you give us your anointing. May you give us words to say. And even as we do not have words to say sometimes when we see our loved ones suffering so much at the bedside, Lord, may you give us a spirit of love and of courage to proclaim of your love to them. So God, we ask for your healing. We ask for your healing for our friends, our loved ones who has been going through such a tough journey of physical ailments. That God, we ask for your strength, your comfort. And especially, Lord, for those who do not know you, we ask of God that you come by them and you speak with them and let them know that you are God who cares for them. You are God who sent people to help them. And let them see you. So God, it's with this that, Lord, we want to pray. We want to intercede on behalf of those for suffering. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we know that you hear our prayers. So, Lord, may your name be glorified. Whatever that has been going to occur, even as we pray, we know that, Lord, is in your precious will. But lead us as your people not to stop praying. Lead us as your people not to stop talking to you. No, church, as we are praying this morning, my discernment is that maybe some of you here have even stopped talking to the Lord our God. But he knows what's in your heart. He's not blaming you per se, but he wants to remind you that he's here waiting for you to come back to him to have that relationship with him again, because he's a God of love that really loves to embrace you. Back to his embrace, even as we come by him, we stop whatever that we are doing, We just speak with Him. Because He's such a relational God. So my Lord, is with this that we also want to pray for our government, especially this season where they are going through a few things, a few crises in the midst. God, we pray for your righteousness. We pray for your justice. But we also pray for your mercy and your love as well. We pray that when all things are being concluded for each of the cases, we pray that, Lord, even as your will be done, indeed your name will be glorified. That God, things will be put into such a way that things will be better for the people. So Lord, it's with this that we want to pray for the people who are given the authority to rule in this country. We pray that, Lord, you'll continue to give them your wisdom. You continue also to strengthen them, strengthen their hearts and their love for the people, especially those who are poor, especially those who are in need, especially those who are the outcasts of the society. We pray, O Lord, for this government to see with your eyes and to do things with your hands. So God, it's with this that we want to intercede. And Lord, today we also want to pray for our youth, for the youth ministry. They're having a harvest event. And we can see just now that, Lord, they have brought friends along, quite a few of them. And we're excited for that. And Lord, we also want to pray that, Lord, even as they get together in activities, fellowship, we pray, oh Lord, that you continue to use our youth so mightily for the love and to speak into their hearts that, Lord, they will come. They'll continue to come, not just about the church, but that, Lord, about your people who bring them the light of Christ in their lives. So, Lord, we thank you for that. And we just continue to pray that they will have a great and a fruitful time later on. Thank you, Jesus. And, Lord, finally, we want to pray for the protection of rights for the migrant workers in our midst. Lord, the economy has opened up and companies have been hiring more and more workers, but sometimes they missed out on planning for their stay here. And this has become a problem. Lord, we pray that, Lord, the government and also the agencies and even the companies will work together so that, Lord, the welfare of the workers in our midst can be taken care of. Lord, we pray for our church, even as we continue to reach out to this portion of the migrant workers in our midst. We pray that, Lord, you will give us that unyielding love for them. That, Lord, even as we serve, they can see your love. They can see Christ in each of those who's going to go there and serve. So, Lord, we thank you. We thank you so much for hearing our prayers. And we just want to close this time of prayer, of intercession with the Lord's Prayer. And we're just going to pray this together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Very good morning, church. Yes, even as the Lord welcomes us, because this is His place, His sanctuary, we also want to welcome one another. Okay, especially if you are new to us, I'd like to just encourage you to just maybe just wave your hand, anybody. You don't have to stand up, just wave. Anyone new to us here? Anyone? Your mail? I can see Yala. New, right? Hi, hello. welcome. Yeah, my name is Jason. I'm one of the pastors here. Our pastor in charge, Pastor Ming Lee, is seated over there. Okay. Anyone else new to us? If not, let us stand and let us pass the peace of Christ to one another, shall we? May the peace of the Lord be with you. Now we're going to, thank you, praise the Lord. Yeah, we're going to move to the family news. Today, I think we only have one announcement.
And I have some, you know, sometimes they'll give notes to the announcer. So this note's quite long. Let me read it out. If not later, say I never read. Okay. Okay, anyway, we have only one announcement for this. This is for the health screening, okay, for the migrant workers. So for those of you who are involved in this, you can listen up. And if you have not signed up, you can take notes of some of what I'm going to say as well. This is going to be on the 30th of July, okay? And the briefing time is going to be 5 p.m. at Hall 3, okay? But the event time is 6 to 9:30 p.m. And this, will, of course, will be at Tukang, okay, dormitory. And it said that they have actually gone down to Tukang dormitory in the past week to actually recce for the health screening that will be happening. For those of you who have participated, right, last year, they have considered your feedback to make the health screening better. So you have noticed that they have removed the mental health assessment for this year, okay, for the station, right? And so it's decided that they will not have this station anymore. In case some of you have any queries, right, you look at all the stations and all that. So you realize that that is actually taken out. And they are also in need of nurses, okay? Any nurses around us, okay? Please, they're in need of this, okay? Or student nurses also can. And that's, I think, basically for station 4, for the blood glucose station. They're in need of nurses, okay? So if you think you can help out in this area, please sign up for it, okay? And you can just look at all of this, all right? So they will need help in traffic control, registration, height and weight, blood pressure, of course, the blood glucose, and of course, doctor consultation. This for those of you who are doctors, all right? And note takers for doctors as well, okay? So just to encourage you to sign up for this. If not, you can also keep this activity, this program in prayer, okay? That the Lord will use people to minister to the migrant workers in our midst. I think that's all for the announcement. Do we have any others? All right. Okay. It's time for us to just come to the Lord. Okay. Continue to come to the Lord in worship as we prepare ourselves to give unto Him His tithes and our offerings. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, may You help us to remember, even as we give, that all things indeed come from You. Not only the good things, but what we perceive as the bad stuff as well. So Lord, help us to embrace You each and every day. And as we give, Lord, help us to give cheerfully. Help us to give with a generous heart. To reflect that, Lord, indeed You are our God, You are our provider, You are our Lord. Thank You, Jesus. We pray this in Jesus' name. You can come forward with your tithes and your offerings to give unto the Lord. Let's stand for the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures.
Take your seats.
today's scripture, we shall read the entire chapter of 1 Kings chapter 14. Now, this is very much a story, so you can either follow it on the screen or just sit down, sit back, and listen to it. But as you listen, I want you to take, instead of wondering what sort of sin these people have committed and how to avoid it, I want you to take a point of view of God Himself. How does God feel as He sees the things that are unfolding? Now, this is a story of two nations that used to be one nation, two nations that used to be the jewel of God's crown. What has happened to them? So let's listen to these two stories. Let us pray. Father, speak your truths to us. We may know your nature and we may know what you are like. That in doing so, we may know you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. At that time, Abijah, the son of Jeroboam, fell sick. And Jeroboam said to his wife, "Arise and disguise yourself, that it not be known that you are the wife of Jeroboam, and go to Shiloh. Behold, Ahijah the prophet is there, who said of me that I should be king over the people. Take with you 10 loaves, some cakes, and a jar of honey, and go to him. He will tell you what shall happen to the child." Jeroboam's wife did so. She arose and went to Shiloh and came to the house of Ahijah. Now Ahijah could not see, for his eyes were dim because of his age. And the Lord said to Ahijah, "Behold, the wife of Jeroboam is coming to inquire of you concerning her son, for he is sick. Thus and thus you shall say to her." When she came, she pretended to be another woman. But when Ahijah heard the sound of her feet as she came in at the door, he said, "Come in, wife of Jeroboam. Why do you pretend to be another? For I am charged with an unbearable news for you. Go, tell Jeroboam, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, because I exalted you from among the people, and made you leader over my people Israel, and tore the kingdom away from the house of David and gave it to you, yet you have not been like my servant David, who kept my commandments and followed me with all his heart, doing only that which was right in my eyes. But you have done evil above all who were before you, and have gone and made for yourself other gods and metal images, provoking me to anger, and have cast me behind your back. Therefore, behold, I will bring harm upon the house of Jeroboam, will cut off from Jeroboam every male, both bond and free in Israel, will burn up the house of Jeroboam as a man burns up dung until it is all gone. Anyone belonging to Jeroboam who dies in the city, the dogs will eat. And everyone who dies in the open country, the birds of heavens will eat, for the Lord has spoken it. Arise, therefore, go to your house. When your feet enter the city, the child will die. And all Israel shall mourn for him and bury him, for he only of Jeroboam shall come to the grave, because in him there is found something pleasing to the Lord, the God of Israel, in the house of Jeroboam. Moreover, the Lord will raise up for himself a king over Israel, who shall cut off the house of Jeroboam today. And henceforth the Lord will strike Israel as a reed is shaken in the water, and root up Israel out of this good land that he gave to their fathers, and scatter them beyond the Euphrates, because they have made the Asherim, provoking the Lord to anger. And he will give Israel up because of the sins of Jeroboam, which he sinned and made Israel to sin. Then Jeroboam's wife arose and departed and came to Tirzah. And as she came to the threshold of the house, the child died. And all Israel buried him and mourned for him, according to the word of the Lord which he spoke by his servant Ahijah the prophet. Now the rest of the acts of Jeroboam, how he warred and how he reigned, behold, they are written in the book of the Chronicles of the Kings of Israel. And the time that Jeroboam reigned was 22 years, and he slept with his fathers. Nadab his son reigned in his place. Now Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, reigned in Judah. Rehoboam was 41 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 17 years in Jerusalem, the city that the Lord had chosen out of all the tribes of Israel to put his name there. His mother's name was Naamah the Ammonite. And Judah did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and they provoked him to jealousy with their sins that they committed, more than all that their fathers had done. Now they also built for themselves high places and pillars and asherim on every high hill and under every green tree. And there were also male cult prostitutes in the land. They did according to all the abominations of the nations that the Lord drove out before the people of Israel. In the fifth year of King Rehoboam, Shishak, king of Egypt, came up against Jerusalem. He took away the treasures of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house. He took away everything. He also took away all the shields of gold that Solomon had made, and King Rehoboam made in their place shields of bronze, committed them to the hands of the officers of the guard, who kept the door of the king's house. And as often as the king went into the house of the Lord, the guard carried them and brought them back to the guard room. Now the rest of the acts of Rehoboam and all that he did, are they not written in the book of Chronicles of the kings of Judah? And there was war between Rehoboam and Jeroboam continually. And Rehoboam slept with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David. His mother's name was Naamah the Ammonite, and Abijam his son reigned in his place. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Have you ever experienced spectacular failure? Something so bad, something so huge that you'll be ashamed if anyone found out. It could be your studies that you failed so drastically, so spectacularly. It could be your business that just collapsed. Or it could be something moral. Could be even, especially, a failure as a parent. We live in a very success-oriented place. We expect success of good Christians. We expect success of people who follow God. Truth is that often failures are seen as something has gone wrong with you. That if you failed spectacularly, if as a parent especially, your children went wayward, if you were a counselor or worse, a pastor, and your children did not grow up straight and true, people would say, physician, heal yourself. Why is your life falling apart? When I was studying in Asbury, you know, Asbury came out in the news recently about this great revival. And this is not the first time they had a revival. This was at least a second, if not the third, revival where the Spirit of God just poured into the place. What happened in Asbury College, we were in the Bible College, but it was just a two-lane street apart. And of course, the revival spread over to the seminary. It was one of the best seminaries, I think, where Spirit of God was there. And in that college were also very good lecturers. We felt, we experienced their love, their gentleness, their nurture. When I went there, I really felt so nurtured. And yet, if you looked at their family stories, you might think that this was a college that had failed as well. Two of my favorite lecturers, really good ones. One was David Thompson, the late David Thompson. He passed away. He was a very gentle, nurturing, kindly man. He was, in fact, my thesis supervisor for spiritual formation. One day, I heard his story about he had three children. One of them was a girl who married, and then one day her husband ran off with his male secretary. It was scandalous, to say the least. But then one day as I went to for my supervision, I saw him sitting at his desk, face in his hands, sobbing. What had happened was that his son had taken a gun. His son was schizophrenic and refused to take medicine. He had taken a gun, taken the car, and had driven somewhere. And David was just waiting, sitting there waiting for a call from the police, wondering if his son would still be alive. Family tragedies. The other lecturer was Steve Siemens, who was very well-known, very well-known writer on spiritual formation and very nurturing person as well. When I met him, I saw the most patient man. And yet, at one chapel, we heard the chapel praying for his son. His son was addicted, deeply addicted to drugs. Once again, he was deep in drugs. We wondered, what sort of family did these two lecturers come from? I knew their families. I knew their wives, their spouses, their children. The wonderful people, solid marriage. And yet they had children in deep trouble. Failures, perhaps. Perhaps even a shame to the community. But as I thought about it, I thought about that these two families were in good company. They were not an exception. They were in very good company, in fact. I'm not talking about Aaron's children who, you know, Aaron, the first priest, high priest, whose children went astray and messed up. Nor am I even talking about Eli's children who similarly failed. I'm talking about God himself. The God who had to face failure in what was his crown jewel, what was his pride. We remember that God called Israel out of Egypt. That was the start, perhaps. Well, Abraham was maybe the start, but it was the time when God took Israel out of Egypt that the nation started. And Israel was supposed to be the pride, the glory of God, that all the nations who saw the path of Israel would praise God. In fact, Moses, when God wanted to destroy Israel the first time, Moses pleaded with him and said, God, it is for your own glory. It is, if you destroy the people of Israel, the nations will mock you because these are the people, this is the people of yours. And then the golden age when David, the man after God's heart, became king. He had conquest. The nation of Israel prospered, flourished wonderfully. Israel was blessed by David. But within one generation, Solomon already started to fall, to fail. His son, Rehoboam, was a complete failure. He led the nation of Israel far from God. Just two generations, this man who became king, descendant of King David, led his nation into destruction, bullying his people, leading them to atrocities, to idol worship, leading them away from God. And in an effort to stop this abuse, in an effort to preserve the nation of Israel, God tried everything. I mean, he called for Jeroboam. You know, God seldom would make replacements like this. Because this was the house of David. God had promised that the house of David would last forever. But the situation had gotten so bad that God had to preserve at least a portion. And so he raised Jeroboam, whom he said he expected him to be like David, King David, kindly, godly, obedient to God, a great leader, to lead 10 tribes of Israel out of the nation, leaving only Judah to King Rehoboam. But Jeroboam was also a dismal failure. And so we see the details in this story that we just heard. First of all, we look at Jeroboam and how far he had fallen. And this was not even one generation, it was his own generation. He himself was called by God to lead the people of Israel out of a corrupted Israel. He was God's anointed to be the king. But within his, not even his generation, he himself, he first fell. He first fell by allowing his people to worship in idols in Israel outside of Jerusalem. God had called Jeroboam to lead the people back to Jerusalem to worship. But Jeroboam was scared, and so he erected shrines and worship places in Israel, in the tribes of Israel. But in this story, we see something even worse. Abijah's son was sick. Jeroboam's son, Abijah, was sick. And Jeroboam wanted to know what would happen. He had already been told by other prophets that Israel would be taken away from him. He wanted to try his luck again. Instead of consulting God, he went back to Prophet Ahijah. Prophet thinking that Prophet Ahijah was the one who told him that he would be king. But he didn't want to show himself, so he asked his wife to disguise herself and go and ask Ahijah. Ahijah, before even Ahijah saw Jeroboam's wife, God had already told him, this woman who's coming to you is the wife of Jeroboam. You need to tell him the bad news. What this story says is that Jeroboam didn't even believe God anymore. I mean, he was, first of all, I mean, how do you fool God, right? How do you ask your wife to go and see a prophet and say, hey, how's my child? Do you think God can't see? Obviously, he wasn't even thinking of God. He was thinking of fooling the prophet Ahijah. And God was already outside of the equation. And he was resorting to asking Ahijah, the prophet, because Ahijah had actually promised him that he would be king. And so rather than listen to the other prophets who had told him that he had lost the kingdom, he rather turned to Ahijah, who gave him the good news in the first place, to ask, well, can you then continue my dynasty? Can you heal my son? But in all of this, he showed that his hope, his faith was in one man who gave him good news. His hope and faith was in a man whom he thought would heal his son. He thought nothing of God. From a man whom God had called to lead the whole of Israel, whom God had expected to be the replacement for King David, something like King David, Jeroboam had already become a man who did not talk to God, did not believe in God, thought that he could fool God's people, wanted to hold on to the promise that God had given him. So far had Jeroboam fallen. But it's not just his falling. Because of his sin, the whole of Israel would go through a series of atrocities. You could look at that as God's punishment. You could also look at it as a political situation. Because when the king was that corrupt, then the nation would fall. But what God said of the calamities that were to come were terrible. That the people who died in the city would be eaten by dogs. The people who died outside the city would be eaten by birds. To be eaten by dogs is actually a great insult, a great curse. It's one thing to die. It's one thing to die and be buried properly. It's another thing to have your body strewn on the streets and have dogs eat your body or have birds come to feed on you. What God was saying is that the tragedies, the calamities that would befall Israel would be so bad that no one would be there to bury your dead. They would just be thrown on the streets and eaten with no respect. In fact, the son, Abijah, the son of Jeroboam, was the fortunate one. As a child, he died of sickness, and that was considered fortunate. In fact, the prophet said that because he did things that were pleasing to God, in verse 13, for he only of Jeroboam shall come to the grave, because in him there is found something pleasing to the Lord. The people would give him a proper burial, even though he died as a child. That was the best thing that could happen. Everyone else died on the streets, eaten by dogs, were not buried. Such was the situation. As you look at the situation of God's called people, second time called out from a corrupt nation, the destruction that would befall the nation of Israel. What a stench, what a shame. Then we turn to house of Judah under Rehoboam. We see then that King Shishak, king of Egypt, came and plundered the house of the Lord, plundered the king's house as well, took away all the gold. You know how ironic that is? God had taken Israel out of Egypt. And remember that as God took the people of Israel out of Egypt, they also kind of plundered the wealth of the Egyptians. They did not rob them, but the people of Egypt, the Egyptians, gave freely to the people of Israel as they said goodbye to them. And then we look at the Golden Age, where King David and then King Solomon had amassed so much wealth, so many treasures. And it ended up that Egypt took all of them. I mean, this tragedy where it says that Egypt, Shishak, took away the shields of gold that Solomon had made, and Rehoboam made in their place shields of bronze. That was how tragic, how pathetic it was that they had so much wealth, and they ended up in total poverty. Both nations had been destroyed. But what was worse was in verse 30, and it says there was war between Rehoboam and Jeroboam continually. When you start thinking about Israel as the beloved, as the child, as the begotten child of God, as the jewel of His glory, as a nation that had been set up to show the nations what it meant to be God's chosen ones. And looking at it now, two nations out of one fighting each other, two nations that were falling apart from the other enemies and from each other. Imagine God standing there and looking at the nation and facing the mockery of all the other nations. The kingdom set up by God, the nation set up by God is now in total disgrace. They are now mocked. They're now the laughingstock of all the nations. God was their king. Imagine the shame, the pain. And we remember then the story of the prodigal son too, where the father had to face his neighbors because his son had walked out and destroyed his life. But if you were to think of any of those parents, my two lecturers, Steve Siemens and David Thompson, as failures in parenting, you can imagine how God felt as he stood there with his nation that had come, that had broken into two. That's, of course, not the end of the story. In the coming months, maybe many months later, we'll hear that even though the nation of Israel failed and failed and failed and messed themselves up so badly, God did not stop loving them. That one day then God would come himself or send his son to come himself and then take that shame and still refuse to be ashamed of his people, but hold their shame, hold their sin, and then bring reconciliation. Not as an avenging God, but as a God who forgave, a God who was compassionate, a God who would do anything to redeem them. But that's for a later time. Today we want to spend time looking at the pain that God experienced when his children walked away from him. What then do we do? What's the practical aspect? Well, first of all, take time to weep and to feel the pain of God. We are often very action-minded people. We find out what should we do then, and we rush to do it. And yet the first thing about life, about love, and about friendship is that you stay there and appreciate the pain that the other person is feeling, and you weep with the person. In human relations, that is a truth, that is a reality. I was reminded of this several years ago in my previous church. We were very, very embroiled in a huge fight over an issue. The two sides were so convicted, neither side wanted to give in. We were so sure that we were right, either that or we were so proud of ourselves that we refused to let go. But it became a situation where nothing moved. No one was willing to yield. In fact, we were so frustrated with each other that tempers flared, temperature shot up. We were just angry that the other side would not yield even one bit. And then as there was a deadlock, the leader of the opposition, so-called, paused and said to me, "I will not fight you, Pastor." And then I looked at him, puzzled. And he said, "I will not fight you because of what you did for me 20 years ago." And I was like scratching my head and saying, "I barely knew this guy anyway." Then he said, "20 years ago, I came to church office because I have totally broken. I lost my job, my business collapsed, my marriage was falling apart, and I needed a counselor. And I came and saw you." That was my first month, I think, in the church. "Came and I saw you and I told you my story. You did nothing. He just started to cry. But at that moment, I found strength. I realized that someone cared enough to cry for me. And that made all the difference in my life." Suddenly, I remembered that story. I was a rookie. And when he came in, I felt totally hopeless and helpless. How to help men like that? Not trained, just a man who had lost everything crying. And I started to cry too. But that was it. Just the thought that someone cried with you. Most unprofessional thing, by the way. Someone bothered to cry. And that made a difference to a person. And over the years, I've learned that truth too. often people don't need advice. They may not even need help. Eventually, they'll find the help. But what they need is for someone to feel their pain. It is the same with God. The God also wants us to feel his pain first before rushing in to do work. I remember in during the charismatic revival in Singapore, where people started speaking in tongues, doing miracles, prophesying and all that. It was a wonderful, wonderful gift of God. It was a wonderful gift that turned sour. Because then the two sides, the charismatic and the non-charismatic, became enemies. The charismatics became very arrogant, that we have something that you don't have. And the non-charismatics became defendant and said, you have whatever you have is fake. And so there was very vicious fighting within the church. A certain church leader by the name of Mr. Tan, he was one of the first charismatics in that church, and he celebrated the life, the new life that the Holy Spirit had brought. But as he saw the church falling apart, he was so overcome with grief. One day after service, where everyone had gone, he rushed to the altar, held onto the altar, and wept and wept and wept. But that was the start of reconciliation as well. Before he could do anything, he felt the pain of God at seeing his church falling apart. You see, the story of Israel and Judah is not the last of these stories of the pain of God. Today, even today, as we look at a church that is split, not here, but in many places, the church is splitting. But we see also the atrocities that take place, Christians against other Christians, Christians against non-Christians, judgmental spirit. And we know then that this fight, this between Israel and Judah, is not over yet. That God still feels the pain of a church, of a world that is falling apart. And so it is necessary first to be still, be silent, and to ask God, God, let me know your heart. Let me know how sad you are when you look at this situation. After a while, we begin to feel the same sadness. It is this sadness that draws us to make a difference, to cry to God, to pray to God. We remember two stories. First was Jesus as he walked into Jerusalem, and he saw Jerusalem. He saw what it was, but he also saw what it was to be. And Jesus wept. As he said, God, as God, I would have wanted to put you under my wings, but you would not. And so there will be destruction. Jesus felt deep pain that God, the same pain that God was experiencing. The other is Nehemiah. When Nehemiah saw the city, the gates of the city of Jerusalem fall apart, he wept as well. Even Jesus, as he was in Gethsemane, he would have longed for his disciples when he had brought near to him to stay awake and feel his pain. They all fell asleep, and Jesus went to trial alone, went to pray alone. The reality, the truth is that God really wants us to feel his pain, to share that pain first, to sit still, not to rush, not to do something else, but just to sit still, to feel his pain. Second application may well be that, we stop comparing and judging. Because within our church, there will be children who do very well, children who don't do very well, people who do well in lives, and people who fall by the wayside. And I think we need to cry, weep with those who weep, and to rejoice with those who rejoice. I've pastored in churches where the comparisons were really grave. Your son got how many A's? Which school? Got into which university? Graduate already, go do what? Your son's still unemployed. And the comparisons are just so grave. I've seen it within families too. Hey, your cousin got 2 marks more than you. And things like that. And yet, then we begin to learn that, well, God's children didn't do too well. Neither did the children of many godly people. And instead then of comparing and saying probably something wrong with them, we learn to weep with them. We learn to journey with them and feel their pain. to feel the joy as well when they do well. And third, this is for parents especially. As God loved His children through the worst of their lives, love your children through the worst of their lives. The story is not ended yet. The story continues and continues. Because even the prodigal son came back to his father. At this point, the children may be wayward. The children may really be doing badly. You may feel like at times disowning them, or, well, instead of disowning them, just kill them. But stay on with them. Keep loving them. As God loved His nation, Israel, as God loved the church, as God loves us. Let us pray. Father, as we read and hear stories of your nation going through difficult times because of their disobedience, that the pride and joy, your pride and joy, became a stench, a shame, a laughingstock in all the nations. Even, Lord, as we look at our church, not just Agape, but the church in general, church universal, as we look at the atrocities that the church commits, as we look at the splits, conflicts within churches, as we look at the hatred and the lack of grace and love that your church displays, Father, help us to feel your pain, not to judge, but to feel your pain. And to know that through it all, you love your church, regardless of how bad it is. And then, Lord, we look at ourselves as well. We look at how we have failed, how through our sin we have brought calamities upon ourselves. Sometimes we have simply brought calamities upon others. Father, you continue to love us as well. So God, teach us first to feel your pain. Teach us then to feel the pain of others, and to come alongside and to weep with one another, and then rejoice with one another as well. Father, we ask then for each of us parents, so we may continue to love our children regardless of whether they excel or they fail. Teach us, Lord, as you have shown us in your life and the death of our Lord Jesus Christ. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Church, let us rise to worship God with this song. Let the song, the words of the song, minister to us.
We bow our hearts, we bend our knees. O Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. O Lord, we cast down all idols. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. We bow our hearts, we bend our knees. O Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. O Lord, we cast down our idols. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us must not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, oh, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks, that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob.
Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you now and always. Amen. Please take your seats.